So I have the pleasure of introducing the first speaker of this last session, Devrim Semizer-Kuming, from the state research institution responsible for forestry in Baden-Württemberg, and she will be giving us the second chapter of the story about ash dieback. The floor is yours.
Thank you. I'm really happy to be here. It's been great and a lot of exchange and a lot of also learning and being up to date opportunities about a lot of topics and and thanks for coming back from the coffee break. It will be difficult to adjust after the coffee break, but perhaps my job is a little bit easier because in the morning session Eric talked about ash dieback problem going on in Europe, and perhaps it will be a quick adjustment for you. So, as you see, my topic is genetic management of European ash forests in the face of ash dieback through enrichment plantings. The study was funded by the European Commission FONASO program and conducted by two collaboration of two universities, the University of Göttingen in Germany and the University of Copenhagen in Denmark. We all heard that common ash is an ecologically and economically important tree species in Europe, and it's widespread. And the important thing is, it's for my study, is it's wind pollinated and wind dispersed. And regular fruiting starts at around 20 years of age. Seeds mature in fall and disperse in winter, several months it takes. And some seeds can stay on the trees for the next summer. And the seeds experience deep dormancy, and the species interestingly shows this polygamous system, and we can find purely male flowers, and we can also find purely female flowers, and all kinds of range in between as hermaphrodites. It's known as self-fertile, but it's in reality, in nature, it's really in low in frequency. And the species is regarded as functionally dioecious. So perhaps not to talk about ash dieback, how common it is, but we can see that this emerging fungal disease almost infected all the ash trees throughout the range distribution. So it's originated from Asia, and since the 1990s, it's been spreading. So perhaps the good news is there are a lot of studies showing that there's heritable genetic variation in disease susceptibility, and this could be a potential for the species to recover in the long run through natural selection. But because the frequency of tolerant trees are really low in frequency in nature, so perhaps the process can be, or is it possible to support the process through enrichment plantings with tolerant material, tested material, of course. And but this, the whole process will depend on, of course, how many survivors we will have in the end, and how reproductively they will be successful, and how much gene flow and what kind of pattern of gene flow we will get to spread these genes from tolerant genes, let's say, from planted to the surrounding infected forests. This is the main question. So based on this introduction, we wanted to investigate seed and pollen dispersal patterns in two study fields, Rosenbeck is in Germany, and Valbyhain is in Denmark. And we also wanted to test the hypothesis if it is really true that healthy tolerant trees have more or higher reproductive success compared to unhealthy or susceptible ones. So we wanted to test this hypothesis also into sites in Denmark where we have a prevalent disease issue. It's the disease is quite highly prevalent in Denmark. So quickly looking at how we've done that, for the seed and pollen dispersal patterns in these two sites, as you see, the Rosenbeck site in Germany is a highly fragmented forest type, and we studied these gene flow in between these planted trees, ali trees, and these native small private ash forest. And in here, you see this is the Valbyhain forest in Denmark, which is a continuous mixed forest. And they have interesting stories. So the story about this Valbyhain forest, it's very interesting. The green dots are representing the planted stands. They were established in 1958 from precisely 8 clones which were grown in this seed orchard. So, and they're half sieves, so they're open pollinated. So we know the origin of this seed, this material. And the rest of the stands, orange, I can say, surrounding stands are known to be established or they're putatively Danish origin. And according to the records, we can see that they've been there since 1939, 1945. So the sampling strategy is, perhaps I can talk about here, the ali trees, the genetic analysis of the ali trees showed that there is actually vegetative propagation. So in the end, it turned out to be I only had 9 genotypes. So it was also very, perhaps I was lucky to be able to determine if there is any gene exchange between them. So as you see, this shows how much adult trees we sampled and how many planted, how many native, and the seedlings and the seeds. Seeds were sampled in this area, in the native forest, and from 10 trees. And you see the white dots, they're like transects, and this is where I sampled the seedlings. And here, the stars are mother trees. We have 11 mother trees in here and in here. These are they look like a bit marginal. Also seedling, some number of seedlings I sampled is 399. So, and the second part is to investigate was reproductive success in the trees. And health in relation to health. So I already showed you this site in Valbyhain, this continuous mixed forest. And here, this is another story. Eric showed you, mentioned a little bit earlier. This is a clonal seed orchard, which is established in 1998 with 39 ash clones. And when we sampled the seeds, in 2012, there was already really high mortality, which was from 5 to 22 rametes per clone left. So we sampled 285 seeds from 3 mother trees, which were basically located in the center of the site. And you see the difference in between a dead tree, almost dying tree, and a very healthy one. So data collection, I collected a lot of information about the trees, which were naturally height and DBH, flower type, and maybe it would be worth to mention that we came up with this analysis of gender or scoring of gender and femaleness, which is also important in determining these in paternity and parentage analysis, because many studies would and do consider that the closest parent should be the mother tree, but it's not always the case. So in this case, these observations are based on 2 years flower observations, and Welbehein and Rosenbeck, I scored them as male, female, or hermaphrodite. And in Tussenes, there was a precise several years of observation, flower observation, and it's like 1 to 9 scale of percent female score. So it was quite precise. So it really helped us a lot. And I scored flowering intensity, fruit set, and of course crown damage due to ash dieback in relative percent damage. So I was also interested in finding out, because it's wind dispersed and wind pollinated species, so how, of course, we would expect that wind should have some effect on this dispersals. So we tested this in Rosenbeck. As you see, I will talk about it a little bit later. So more conventionally, I didn't use any SNPs, but I used microsatellites, which actually gave quite a lot high resolution, and for the paternity analysis and parentage analysis. So let's look at the results. First, mating patterns or dispersals in the German site, which is the fragmented site. So when we look at the graph, this first graph, we see that most of the parents of the seedlings and the seeds were actually native trees in the site, native trees, not from the alley trees. And we see that there's very limited, like 2% gene flow from the cultivated trees. And when we, more importantly, when we look at the pollen immigration and simulated it, and to find about the probability, cumulative probability distributions of seed and pollen, we can see that there is high immigration of pollen from outside, which is actually checked by two methods, which is one is service. It's based on realized results, realized paternities and parentages, and the other one is a neighborhood model. So when we look at the potential dispersal distances, we see that maybe only 1% of the seeds can disperse, or the ability to disperse, or the chance to disperse more than 94 meters. But if you look at the pollen, it's like 4.5 kilometers, which is a lot. Realized dispersal distances gave us the idea about the dispersal distances in relation to what we can think of if we think about enrichment planting. So what we can see is most of the dispersal distances are they coincide with 100 meters, occurred within 100 meters. Okay, so when we look at the wind data, of course there is an effect of wind direction and wind speed on dispersal events. So perhaps we can start from here. These graphs are circular histograms. So this is the wind data. The wind data, I collected it from or downloaded from the very, like from a local weather station only a few kilometers away from the site. And during the pollination season. And this is the pollen data. And it's in agreement with the wind data. You could see there's a lot of pollen pollination all around the angle, different angles. But when you see the mean angles, it's also coincide with the wind. So these are the directions. It's not exactly the same with seed dispersal. Perhaps if you want to discuss and be curious about it, oh my goodness, okay, then I can talk about it later. Please ask. And dispersal distances and wind speed is also very interesting to check because it is negatively correlated in pollen, but positively correlated for seeds. So pollen immigration is also very prevalent in well behind this continuous forest, and similar dispersal distances and the abilities and potential of long distance dispersal we found, it was about 3 kilometers. And we also detected high gene flow from planted trees. We could also see that these are the seedlings, and frequency of seedlings, and the distances on these transects, two transects that we put here. And they are actually resulted from what we can say, the red one shows the single parent is only from planted trees, and the blue one is also showing both parents are from planted trees. This shows that perhaps it's expected that increased distance from the planted sites or decreasing the probability. And when we look at the reproductive success results in Tucanes in relation to ash dieback susceptibility, we can show that both female sites and male sites, the regression analysis show that there is high correlation in between ash dieback susceptibility and the reproductive success of both males and females. But the effect was stronger on the female side rather than on the male side. And maybe we can discuss it again later. When we checked the result in well behind, this previous one was actually a clonal seed orchard. So we wanted to test this hypothesis also in the nature, in the forest, in situ. So the question is, we questioned the same offsprings and the mature trees, and we also came up with this result showing that crown damage is negatively affecting both females and males' reproductive success. And when we checked the results, these pie charts are showing that all assigned parents are actually healthier than the population, their population average. And summary of the results? Okay, sorry. Should I stop? Okay. Perhaps I can just go. When we look at the seed and pollen dispersal, we should perhaps like this. Now I'm stressed. We see that there is long distance dispersal in the species, and together with high genetic diversity, it suggests that the species might have adaptation ability. And gene flow is an efficient landscape process in ash, both in fragmented and continuous forests. And the effective barrier to seed dispersal is, we can consider in based on our study, 140 meters, which can be used for enrichment plantings. And long distance dispersal, but it could be a problem for gene conservation stands. So we have to also keep in mind that pollen, even though it's rare, pollen can travel kilometers. And mating patterns, of course, are affected by several factors. But the most important thing, negative effect of ash dieback on reproductive success, which may mean that we may have a more tolerant next generation. There's a problem with climate change, of course, and the introduction of new pests and pathogens. And this is the example, and this is emerald ash borer. It's right now, if you look at this map, there fungus and the emerald ash borer is actually meeting, they're coexisting in Russia, and emerald ash borer is coming towards the west, so it's coming towards Europe. So this will present another problem, and we need to understand the disease mechanisms better. But in the meantime, we can perhaps think about if enrichment plantings can be an option for the supporting the natural selection ongoing in ASH, and perhaps the most importantly, the true recovery of the species will actually depend on the speed and efficiency of all kinds of landscape processes. Thank you. Sorry.
Of course, I have to acknowledge a lot of people.
Yeah, I have to acknowledge a lot of people. Of course, I wouldn't have done everything by myself. And thank you.
Yeah, perhaps short enough.
Thank you for the presentation. Sorry to put pressure on you. I would like to ask if there's questions from the floor.
So you present that there is a complex sexual system in ASH with more female flowers and so on.
Yes.
Is there variation of how the gender composition affect the reproductive success? Well, I assume that more female individuals have higher female reproductive success, but how reproductive success vary among gender, and does it interact with the effect of ASH dieback on reproductive success? You see what I mean? Did you test for interaction between gender and...
Yes, but what we can say, these are reproductive success results based on real observations. So when I observe them and assign them, not only genetically through paternity or parentage analysis, but also I double check them with the gender assignments that I observed. So I only consider the ones that which are considered, which were consistent, and for male, female, or hermaphrodite male, because most of the hermaphrodites are known to act as females. There are a lot of female flowers, but I had to check them one by one for the matching, if it makes sense or not. So all the mismatching ones are excluded. And yes, both ASH dieback has both negative effect on reproductive success for both females and males, but the effect is weaker on the male side. Perhaps it could be related to the cost of reproduction for needed for seeding versus flowering and pollen release.